solution for this crime was non-existent and brought on by your own cowardice, ego, and sense of self-importance. For such a violent act to occur with no warning, after no provocation, save being asked to leave a private establishment, shows the danger that you could pose to society if you would ever go free. I also particularly find, pursuant to Revised Code Section 2929.14CB, that at least two of these offenses were committed as part of a course of conduct, and the harm caused by two or more of these multiple offenses was so great and unusual that no single prison term for any of the offenses committed as part of this course of conduct adequately reflects the seriousness of your actions. In addition, Part C of that same subsection of statute applies, as I find that your history of past criminal conduct in the trade of drug dealing and your past conviction for possession of a firearm in violation of the law demonstrates that consecutive sentences are necessary to protect the public from future crime by you. Victims in this case are many, Mr. Ivery, and I'm just talking about the people that were in the bar that night. Dave Wolcady, who you had the misfortune to encounter when you returned to the bar. Mr. Wolcady knew that you'd been kicked out. Prior to your returning, I don't believe he ever said a word to you. At least I didn't observe that on the video. During your trial testimony, much was said by you of the supposed threat and fear that you felt in encountering Mr. Wolcady. Yet other than using harsh language to tell you to leave, Mr. Wolcady never laid a hand on you. If anything, he blocked your path and slowed you down. But he didn't stop you. Ultimately, you chose to walk around him. He took a bullet in the abdomen and clearly almost died because of you. Yet you claimed you were the one in fear. The court does not believe that. Miss Imhoff, having a good time, minding her own business, and yet she was shot through the arm, and also to her horror, saw her friend Dave fallen on the ground, bleeding everywhere. Mr. Russell, another off-duty police officer just sitting at the bar who had no idea what was happening, but felt the sting of the bullet as it passed by him, miraculously missing him. Officer Russell then went outside and saw his fellow officer lying on the ground in mortal danger. And he was able to have enough presence of mind to pull out his badge and start organizing the chaos, preserving witnesses for the investigators. I'm sure the sight of his fellow officer down on the ground still haunts him. Mr. Capes sent me a letter. He did not wish to have it read out loud. How eerie it was to watch the video and see Mr. Capes and his girlfriend enter the bar mere seconds before the shooting. And instantly is hit in the foot and cannot walk or move. Not fully healed 11 months later, we saw him limp as he walked up to this jury, or to this witness box to testify. David Eisel, we saw the bullet hole that ripped through his windbreaker, right over his heart. Miraculously not hitting his body as he threw himself into the path of that bullet, along with Justin Weinbrenner. So someone must have plans for Mr. Wolcady, Ms. Imhoff, Mr. Capes, Officer Russell, and Mr. Eisel, because they had a brush with death that night and each was spared. One was not. You ripped a man away from this society and you took a devoted son and brother, a proud and caring father, a loving husband-to-be, a loyal friend, a proud public servant, and a police officer. And by all accounts, a great police officer. I have been part of the justice system for many years, 28 to be exact. I have been involved in my fair share of murder cases as an attorney and as a judge. These cases bear many similarities: a wrongful act, the loss of a loved one, and two grieving families. While not personally involved or acquainted with either of these families, aside from this case, I can tell you, I feel their grief. I can see and feel the grief of the Weinbrenner family. Likewise, I feel the grief of your family. No one talks much about the offender's family, but I want them to know. I see their grief too. I heard it in the mitigation hearing. I'm sure Justin's family did too. But this case is different. And it is not different for me for the reason you might think. It is not different because Justin Weinbrenner was Akron police officer Justin Weinbrenner. It is different because of the way in which Justin died. I am sure that the values taught to Justin in the police department about sacrifice and service came into play that night. Justin's training was ignited, and the desire to protect others overtook him, I am sure. His is a death the likes of which I have never seen in all my 28 years of working in our justice system. While the homicidal act that you committed was senseless, Justin's death was not. It was sacrificial. Justin laid down his life for his friends. And there is no greater act of love than this. Justin saved lives, and it needs to be said, David Eisel, you saved lives too. For doing this, Justin paid the highest price. But based on everything I have learned and heard about him, there's no question that if he were put in the exact same situation again, he would not hesitate. He would do it again. Mr. Ivery, you have made many mistakes in your life, but you have done some good things. You've also been given many chances. I'm aware of the full nature of those chances. I run a reentry court, and I know you were in one. You have the support of a loving family, and by all accounts, two wonderful sons. So much to live for. But you didn't appreciate it. You chose to let a petty disagreement brought on by your own behavior ruin your future. You wreaked havoc and chaos when you marched back into that bar, believing yourself to be insulted and disrespected. What a woefully tragic decision you made that night. Tragic for Justin and tragic for your family. And while you stand here still drawing breath, justice demands that you never again breathe air as a free man. You will never again walk among us as a free man. You will spend your days and nights surrounded by countless other prisoners bound by the fateful choices they have made in their lives. You will die in prison. And while you may be feeling sorry for yourself, remember, you can write to and call and speak with your family. Justin's daughter, Charlie, will never hear her daddy speak to her again. You can make friends and smile and talk and socialize. Justin's smiles and hugs, which we all witnessed him give to others as he entered Papa Don's that night on the video, they are no more. You will be guarded and protected by others 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. But Justin guards and protects no more. You will have a life. Justice is gone from this earth. So for your actions, this court pronounces the following sentence, which you fully deserve. I am bound by the recommendation of the jury. Legally, the court must impose a sentence of life without parole as to count one, the aggravated murder of Justin Weinbrenner. As to the...